When you think about machine health monitoring, what comes to mind? A really big stethoscope? I know. Me too. In the era of Industry 4.0, however, in order to keep tabs on the health of our industrial systems, we need cyber-physical systems. And front and center in those systems are, you guessed it, smart sensors. From vibration detection to motion detection to angle measurement, smart sensors are key to keeping our IIoT machines healthy and happy. I know, still not as cool as a giant stethoscope. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Today, we are talking about one of the most important players in our smart sensor setup, the accelerometer. Alex Chernikov from Rohm Semiconductor joins me to discuss Rohm's KX132-1211 and KX134-1211 accelerometers for industrial applications. We take a closer look at what sets these accelerometers away from the rest of the pack, the key considerations we should think about when it comes to machine health monitoring, and the role that advanced data path plays in the success of these accelerometers. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about this topic from Rohm Semiconductor. Hi, Alex. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Amelia.
Okay, so we're talking about accelerometers for industrial applications today, which means we're also talking about Industry 4.0, right? But Alex, before we dig into the details, how did we get to where we are today?
So the first industrial revolution was marked by a transition from hand production methods to machines through the use of steam power or water power. The second industrial revolution resulted from installation of extensive railroad and telegraph networks, which allowed for a faster transfer of people, ideas, and electricity. And increasing electrification allowed for factories to develop the modern production line as we know it. The third industrial revolution, also known as the digital revolution, that occurred in the late 20th century and probably can be traced to the production of the Z1 computer, which used binary floating point numbers and Boolean logic. This marked the beginning of the more advanced digital developments. And now we are coming to the fourth industrial revolution. The term Industry 4.0, or shortened to I4.0, sometimes just I4, originated in 2011 from a project in the high-tech strategy of the German government, which promoted the computerization of manufacturing. So there are four really key principles that identify Industry 4.0. One is interconnection, and that's the ability of the machine, devices, sensors, and people to connect and communicate with each other via the Internet of Things. The other one is the information transparency. The information transparency provides operators with comprehensive information to make decisions. And this is based on collected immense amounts of data and information from all points in the manufacturing process. The third is the technical assistance. The technological facilities or systems will assist humans in decision-making and problem-solving. And that will help humans, you know, with the ability to solve many tasks. And the final key point of the Industry 4.0 is decentralized decisions. This is basically the ability of the cyber-physical systems to make decisions on their own and to perform their task as autonomously as possible. For us here, the four top trends for the Industry 4.0 that we identify for our business at Rohm is the predictive maintenance, smart sensors, smart factory, and 3D printing. Here at Rohm, we'll have a solution for smart sensors and predictive maintenance part of it.
So Alex, specifically in terms of machine health monitoring, what are the big players in this field?
The big players in machine health monitoring today are some of the companies like Shoreline IoT, Regal, Parker, Emerson, Fluke, Banner, Nikola Labs, Waits, Goldspalm, Traconomy, and Herbest Instruments. This is just a few of the names, small and large companies that dedicated their time and resources to provide with equipment, hardware, and software in the machine health monitoring space.
Okay, so can you give me some examples of where accelerometers might be used within IIoT?
We can identify several markets and key application examples in industrial IoT. They include industrial pumps, industrial fans, wind turbines, system doors, utility poles, and industrial motors. Each of these market application examples has very wide usage, and some of the markets are really large, especially like industrial pumps and motors, and some are still small but fast growing, like wind turbines.
Okay, so I think I understand the background, but what are we looking at in terms of features for the KX132-1211 and the KX134-1211?
The KX132-1211 and KX134-1211 accelerometers are part of the same family. They both come in the same package in 2x2 millimeters and only 0.9 millimeter high, and both have 12 pins. They both support industry standard operating temperature range from -40°C to +105°C. Both feature fast sampling rate up to 25.6 kHz. They do also both feature the advanced data path, the low standby current of only 0.5 microamps, and low operating power mode that starts from 0.53 microamps. Both parts support SPI and I2C serial interfaces and feature buffer at 512 bytes and work off the 1.7 to 3.6 volt voltage supply. Where the parts differ are in the G range. The KX132-1211 has a full scale range selectable between ±2G to ±16G, whereas KX134-1211 has a G range anywhere between ±8G to ±64G. As a result, the two parts feature a different MEMS sense element. The KX134-1211 is really geared towards measuring signals at higher frequencies. The signal bandwidth for the KX134-1211 part goes up to 8500 Hz, where for the KX132-1211 up to 4200 Hz. So this is basically the main key differences and the main key similarities between the two parts.
Okay, great. Now, can you walk me through how these accelerometers would be used in a real life design?
Sure. The KX132-1211 and 134-12 are accelerometers. They both come with embedded functions that built in and ready to be used with just very basic configuration. Some of those built-in functions are more obvious, like rotation engine. And we all know the application of a smartphone. When we turn the phone from portrait to landscape mode, the picture on your phone switches as well. This is based off the information given to the processor from the accelerometer. The other engine, we call the tap engine, can detect a single tap or double tap. The third engine is a freefall engine, and here, accelerometer detects quickly a freefall and can issue an alert. Some of the common applications for that is like when you drop your hard drive. It's very important to stop rotation of the hard drive before it hits the floor. The fourth one is the wake-up engine, or the motion engine. This engine, or this built-in function, allows detection of any motion or the lack of motion. For example, you pick up an object and you can detect that, or if you left your object or you left your product motionless for a certain period of time, you can detect this too. The final engine, the vibration engine, is really unique to the KX132-1211 and KX134-1211. This built-in function allows detection of different vibration frequencies. And KX132-1211 and KX134-1211 were the industry leaders and pioneers to come up with these built-in functions.
So what sets these accelerometers away from other accelerometer products on the market today?
The standard accelerometer products, they usually feature an accelerometer that can detect the basic motion. And the data from the accelerometer typically is passed to the microcontroller, which will do the more advanced signal processing. It can include filtering, FFT, and when certain signal of interest has been detected, the microcontroller will issue a system alert. What sets KX132 1211 and KX134 1211 with a DP different from the standard accelerometers is that the advanced data path is built into the accelerometer itself. So when accelerometer detects the motion, the advanced filtering and RMS calculation and the alert are happening inside the accelerometer. This allows the microcontroller to be either asleep at this time or do other tasks. As a result, more of the work was offloaded from the main microcontroller to the accelerometer, and that can save the system power as a whole if the microcontroller is left in a sleep mode or some kind of low power mode, or it can offload the tasks and let the microcontroller be efficient in doing other tasks.
That makes sense. Now, Alex, can we dig in a little deeper? What does the data path look like here?
So the advanced data path, or ADP as we call it, is basically separate from what we call the conventional data path. I think before we jump into the advanced data path, it's just good to give a quick overview what the conventional data path looks like. So typically in any accelerometer, there is MEMS, or basically your sense element, which detects the motion. The data from the MEMS usually goes into the analog front end and then being digitized in the A to D converter. Further, there's additional signal processing done, and the signal is passed through typically an IAR low-pass filter, and then it will become available through the output data registers or in the buffer. That's basically a standard conventional data path that you can find in most of the accelerometers today. So what KX132-1211 and 134-1211 bring to the table is the advanced data path, and that's basically an alternative way to route the digital data. The advanced data path consists of three blocks. One is the second order low pass filter. The second block is the first order high pass filter or low pass filter. You can change the configuration in the design time. The third block is the RMS calculation block. Each of these three blocks are highly configurable through the register writes. You can choose to bypass the block if you're not interested, or you can go through the block. Once the data has been processed in the advanced data path, it can also be accessible through the buffer. It can go to the dedicated output registers that are separate from the normal output registers. And this information can go into the motion engine, where the alert will be issued to the microcontroller.
Okay, so Alex, what kind of failures can be measured with this accelerometer?
If we take an example of motors or pumps, there are many different characteristics all those failures have in common. So typically, users would know what is the speed of the pump and the motor, which would go RPM or rounds per minute. And if you experience any of the failures like unbalance or defective anti-friction bearings or misalignments, you would be able to detect a signal at certain frequencies. It can be 2 times or 3 times of the RPM. As an example, with the misalignment of coupling or bearing. And if you detected the signal where you did not expect one, you probably detected a fault. This is basically the nutshell of the machine health monitoring. You're looking for signatures of certain failures. And when you detect them, you can issue an alert to the user.
Okay, so Alex, what kind of solutions would you guys recommend here?
If we continue with the example of the failure of the motor or pump, some of those failures can be observed at specific frequencies. So if you'd like to have a very robust measurement, you can create what we call a bandpass filter. It's basically a filter that will only allow certain frequencies to be visible and the other frequencies will be highly attenuated. The bandpass filter can be created from 2 filters in the advanced data path. The first filter can be set as a second order low pass filter, and the second block in the advanced data path can be set as a high pass filter. The 2 filters will create the bandpass, and through the configuration of the internal register, you can select the bandwidth for each of those filters. So in this example, as we show here in this image, the signal passband will happen in this region. So if we are to detect a signal in this region of interest, this is the signal that we'd like to work with. The other block in the advanced data path is the RMS block. And what we see in the image below is a digital accelerometer output looks more like a step function, more like a DC type signal. Instead of looking like a sine wave, it's looking like a step function. And this is much cleaner signal. This is an average signal. And users have an option to select what the average should look like, anywhere between 2 samples to 256 samples. When you work with RMS signal, you're unlikely to see some spikes on the waveform because everything kind of been smoothed out and averaged. So in this particular example, we show a red line, which for us is the threshold. And we also can, in our motion engine, select a certain time threshold, which here is marked as the TH. So in order for the accelerometer to issue an alert to the microcontroller, we'll be waiting when the ADP will cross the red dotted line. And we also want to start counting the time that the signal stays above the threshold. When the signal stays above the threshold for the duration of time longer than what's marked as TH here, an interrupt to the microcontroller will be issued. To go one level up, what it means is that this tells the microcontroller, we have detected the signal at the frequency you were interested in, and the signal was there and persistent for a certain period of time. That means this is the signal you would like to look at. It's probably a failure, and do what you need to do.
That makes sense. Now, Alex, if I'm ready to get started using these accelerometers, how can you help me?
We're happy to offer a number of solutions to evaluate and test our accelerometers. We are offering the evaluation board for KX132-1211 and KX134-1211. Both evaluation boards are available through distribution. We also offering what we call the ROCX development kit. The ROCX development kit is a complete offering of the software, hardware, and firmware that you can use for the device evaluation. This is an all complete system, and all you have to do is just going to plug the evaluation board into the development kit, use the USB cable connected to your computer, and you'll be able to see all the signals from the accelerometer in real time. You'll have the access to all the registers. You'll be able to configure the sensor the way you want it and monitor the data. You can look at the time domain. You can switch into the frequency domain. You can log the data, and you can also do the register dump. This is a highly visual way to evaluate the sensor and very efficient way and very fast way. And of course, the software comes for free when you buy the development kit.
Excellent. Well, Alex, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, you're welcome. It was my pleasure.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about this topic from Rome Semiconductor. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/EEJournal.